This morning, we're going to be reviewing ideas from the Bhagavad Gita. And today is more of a philosophical day, even though we've been attending to philosophy the whole time, but more specific classical philosophy, I guess you could think of it like that. And we'll be looking at the Bhagavad Gita this morning. We'll be looking at the Yoga Sutras this afternoon. And these are considered to be the primary texts for a dedicated Kriya Yoga practitioner to explore and to study. And in order to do it, we need to learn how to read these texts. And starting with the Bhagavad Gita, a lot of people treat the Bhagavad Gita in the same way a lot of folks treat the Bible. In a literal fashion, meaning they think that there was actually this war that occurred and that there was a living being called Krishna and Arjuna. And that may be so. You know, it may be that there was a legend in which this occurred based on actual fact, but the book itself is not meant to be historical fiction. The book itself is meant to be a metaphor for your own personal path, your own personal spiritual path. So when we're able to read this book, the Bhagavad Gita, in that way, we are able to unlock and understand what is required of us to wake up, to realize what we are beyond our little conceptualizations and the ideas of our small self. And so if you have a copy of the Bhagavad Gita, that's great. The copy that I've always had is called The Eternal Way, The Inner Meaning of the Bhagavad Gita. I think it's still in print. I'm pretty sure it is. I have read some other copies. For example, my other favorite copy is actually, the one by Lahiri Messiah. And also there's another partially done version from Sri Yukteswar. I got to be honest, I never really got too much into Yogananda's. They kind of took it and made it a little too Christianized for me. And that's really not necessary. You know, that made a lot of sense when we were back in the 30s and 40s. And the Ku Klux Klan had the highest number of members ever. So it made sense for, you know, Yogananda to couch his teachings in a very Christian approach. But at this point in time, we don't really need to do that anymore because we don't need to, you know, hide the essence of things. So always remember that when you read about things like that and you notice a really strong Christian flair in maybe an Eastern text, yes, it may be that Jesus had some training with yogis and vice versa and so on. But most of the time it's a little more obvious and a little more pragmatic than that. And we got to remember the time, for example, when Yogananda came to the United States, that it was not really a safe time for a brown skin individual to be here. So you had to do what you had to do, right? Someone asked to show you the cover of my favorite commentary. It's brown, but it's the Eternal Way. I think you can see it. Looks like it's making it backwards on my video. It's not in hardcover anymore. But so when we're looking at this text, there are 18 chapters in this text, and the names of the titles of the chapters, in a sense, relate to the stages of our processes when we are learning to explore our, I guess, spiritual identity. And the most interesting aspect of it all is really the first chapter. And it's called the Yoga of the Despondency of Arjuna. The Yoga of the Despondency of Arjuna. And what do we find in this chapter? We find an individual who's a warrior who finds himself in a situation where he has to fight a battle. and he has to fight a battle against his kinsmen. And he sees this and he becomes overwhelmed with grief. And he eventually drops his bow and says, you know, I cannot do this task. And this is often what happens when we first get involved on our spiritual path, is that we have a feeling, we know something has to be done, we know there's a battle to be fought. But when we actually become aware of the immensity of what needs to be done, we start to get a little shaky and think, are we really able to do this? The next thing that occurs is that we become aware of the fact that we really have to, in a sense, slay all these things that were dear to us. You know, in the Bhagavad Gita, it's our kinsmen, our family. It's the things that make us who we are. And when you read the Bhagavad Gita, you will find references to Krishna saying things like, as he looks out over the battlefield, what he sees are fathers and sons and grandfathers, people that were dear to him. And as we approach our own direction towards inner clarity, what we become aware of is all those things that make us feel that we are who we are, that make us feel safe, that make us feel important, that define our ego and our sense of self, those are the very things we have to slay. You know, when I say things like, look, you can't let your family's obligations and motivations get in the way of your spiritual practice. Most people take a step back and say, what do you mean? You know, my family is dear and beloved to me. Or if I say things like, you're probably going to have to get rid of most of your friends because they're not going to support you on this path, probably. I'm not saying that's always true, but more than likely. People say, I can't do that. Then I'll feel so alone. And, or if I say, you have to change your diet. People are like, what do you mean I have to change my diet? I can't do that. Or you have to start exercising. These are all things that most people, when they become aware of the fact that they have to do all of this to actually have a clearer state of consciousness, or even to be discerning, you know, not just to get all involved in devotion for devotion's sake, but actually think through, what am I really wanting to do here? It's frightening for them. And eventually, for most people, what occurs is they never get past the first chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, which is the yoga of the despondency of Arjuna. Arjuna represents you, your individualized self, aiming to understand what Krishna represents, which is the infinite part of yourself. And they make it to the end of the chapter in their own particular spiritual journey, that first chapter. And they say, I just can't do it. And they drop their bow, which is, the bow represents the uprightness of the spine to meditate well. They drop their bow, they slouch, and they say, I just can't do it. And they don't make it any further than that. And so most people stop at the first chapter, the first of 18 chapters of their spiritual path. Now, when we're thinking about the Bhagavad Gita and the characters in the Bhagavad Gita, you know, we only have about an hour and a half or so to go through this. So I'm just going to give you some ideas of how to think about this. And mainly what we want to consider is Arjuna. Arjuna represents you. Arjuna represents that inspired aspect of yourself that knows he has a duty to do, to clear out his consciousness and to wake up. So Arjuna represents every spiritual seeker, every spiritual warrior, if you will. And Krishna, who rides in the chariot behind him, who doesn't actually get involved in the battle. See, this is what's fascinating. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna doesn't actually get involved in the battle. He's just there to guide Arjuna. And Krishna represents that pure, clear aspect that is fully aware of the infinite and is the infinite. So throughout the Bhagavad Gita, what we have is Arjuna, you, being guided by Krishna, which is why throughout the process, we always have this sense, and a lot of people talk about uniting with Krishna. And really what you're doing there is just having the intention to commune with Krishna in the sense of listening to the guidance that is available to you. And all this is distilled into. And focused in the words of the Bhagavad Gita. And so what I'm going to do is the first thing I'm going to do is read the actual first chapter of the Bhagavad Gita to you. So what I'd like to encourage you to do, which is very wonderful to do anytime you're listening to a talk on spirituality, or you're just directing your mind in this way, is to bring your awareness internal, feel your body, be aware of your breath, and you want to listen with all of your being. So for example, when I would go to retreats, I didn't go there to sit around and think about everything that I was hearing. I went there to listen with all of my being. And I knew that insights and revelations would come when they were ready. When I was really interested in the book, The Power of Now, I didn't actually read the book. What I did was I got the audio version of it, Eckhart Tolle's Power of Now. And I would play it, and you know, Eckhart Tolle was reading it, and I wouldn't think about it. I would just listen to the sound quality of his voice and the words and the space between the words. And that has a real power to bring you fully present. I would do the same thing when I would listen to Alan Watts or Krishnamurti. So you don't want to get overly caught up in the mind, because that's the thing that we're trying to necessarily not define ourselves by anymore. But you just want to listen, staying alert. And if you need to keep your attention at the spiritual eye center to keep you focused and awake, that's even better. So just listen with everything, all aspects of yourself, as we go through the first chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, and then we'll discuss it. So, chapter one, the yoga of the despondency of Arjuna. Assembled in Dharma Kshetra and Kuru Kshetra, desirous to fight, what did my sons and the sons of Pandu do, O Sanjaya? Sanjaya replied, and the person that asked the question was Dhritarashtra, which represents a deluded mind. Okay, so as we go through this, I'm going to tell you what each name, the person's name, what it represents in yourself. So it starts out with deluded mind, and that's how we all start. We all start out in delusion, asking. Assembled in the field of righteousness and the field of unrighteousness, which is our experience, desirous to fight, what did my sons and the sons of Pandu do, O Sanjaya? And the sons of Pandu represent virtuous soul qualities. Sanjaya, or intuitive introspection, so your capacity for intuitive introspection. You know, you've got a deluded mind, and now you need to start contemplating. All right, I'm in delusion, so let's contemplate these things. Sanjaya replied, seeing the army of the sons of Pandu ready for battle, King Duryodhana, approaching his teacher Drona, spoke these words. Behold, O teacher, this mighty army of the sons of Pandu, arrayed by the son of Drupada, who is wise because of your instruction. And how does this translate? Essentially, what we're hearing is that becoming aware of the virtuous qualities, the sons of Pandu, and that they were fully prepared to confront and eliminate all the self-serving tendencies and characteristics, passionate desires that ensure survival, that's what Duryodhana means, directed the mind to its teacher. So we're meeting the mind's teacher, its storehouse of memories, impressions, samskaras, prior perceptions, experiences which support the karmic condition or material life. So the teacher that's spoken of here is the teacher of the mind, the deluded mind. And that represents what? But the storehouse of memories, impressions, prior perceptions, experiences. All these things are what make you feel like you are who you are and you have the karma that you have. So behold, O teacher, this mighty army of the sons of Pandu, arrayed by the son of Drupada, who is wise because of your instruction. So to translate that, O storehouse of memories, see the great assemblage of the virtuous qualities, the sons, born of pure intelligence, Pandu, which is pure intelligence, which are directed by the inner light, a quality of Kundalini, supported by knowledge based on experience. Here are heroes, mighty archers. In battle, they are equal to Bhima, Arjuna, Yuyudhana, and Virata, and the great warrior, Drupada. And so we have the deluded mind and the teacher of the mind being revealed to them. Well, what are they up against? What's on the battlefield? And the battlefield is our life experience. And these are heroic qualities, which are skillful action. In any contest, they are equal to innate strength and life force control, fiery willpower, faith-based determination, and equanimity in all circumstances. So we learn that this battle, in which is going on in our consciousness for freedom, that the qualities that we have to develop that are on our side, essentially, are innate strength, life force control, fiery willpower. You know, you heard me tell you yesterday, sometimes you just got to force yourself to wake up, or you got to force yourself to do something. That's tapping into this willpower. Faith-based determination and equanimity in all circumstances. Sometimes things don't go your way. Sometimes your meditations aren't that great. You have to practice and experience unconditional love, equanimity, and continue forward. That's how you win a war. That's how you win a battle. And then it goes on to say, and I'm not going to use, Dristaketu, Chekatana, the king of Kashi, known for valor, Purujit, Kuntibhoja, and Saibya, who is strong among them. And what does this represent? Restraint, which removes all obstacles, higher intelligence, enthusiasm, mastery of mental and sensory impulses, peace and satisfaction when overcoming obstacles, and concentrated discipline giving superior strength. So as you see, if you would just read this, and you didn't actually think about what those names meant, all you're going to do is be reading very shallowly an account of a type of battle. But if you are able to look into the meaning of these names and what they represent, you get a sense of that they're not talking about an actual battle, like going out and slinging stones and fighting with maces and swords. It's talking about this inner battle. And the other powerful allies, I'm not going to use their names, I'm just going to translate it, are dispassion, bravery in actions, happiness arising from kindness, and the enlivened powers of Kundalini expressing through the chakras, all of them extremely effective. So that's what deluded mind is up against. That's what the army of deluded mind is up against, which are all very helpful things for us. And if you just go through those six verses and you write down these qualities and you decide to develop each of these qualities, that's all you did, you would have learned quite a bit from this text. But let's move on. So in verse 7 it states, "Know now your own distinguished warriors, O highest of the twice born. I describe the leaders by their proper names." So here we have intuitive introspection, sharing with deluded mind. Who's on your side? You know, what's going to support you? Deluded mind. So be aware of whom your army consists. I shall name and describe them. There is yourself, deluded mind. There is Bhishma, Karna, Kripa, Asvataman, who is victorious in battle, Vikarna, also the sons of Somadatta. And what does that represent? So this is what's supporting your deluded state. Memories of experiences which support change and transformation. A strong sense of individuality. So anytime we're having a discussion and you start to get a little ruffled and think, oh, that's not right, you know, that's, I'm not sure about that. This guy doesn't know what he's talking about. Well, ask yourself, are you doing that because that's true from intuitive introspection? Or is it because your strong sense of individuality is saying, no, I'm not going to accept that because that's threatening my individualized sense of self? Worldliness, which is attached to superficial and transient things and circumstances. Hatred or strong dislike. Inconstancy, not staying true to your path. And many other heroes willing to risk their lives for my sake, with various weapons at their command and all of them skilled in battle. So, and this translates to, and the many other psychological tendencies with addictive drives to protect and support strong desire, with their many ways of expressing and all of them effective in their actions. Our army guarded by Bhishma is sufficient. The army guarded by Bhima is insufficient. So here we have deluded mind believing that all these negative qualities are going to be able to overcome the virtuous qualities. So the psychological tendencies and drives defended by a strong sense of individuality are sufficient to meet the challenge. The virtuous qualities defended by life force control are insufficient. So the virtuous qualities defended by life force control are insufficient. Therefore, during the process of this contest, let each of you be in your assigned places and protect Bhishma. So in this contest about to begin, this challenge for you to wake up, the command is for all these self-serving tendencies to play their specific role and to protect individualized awareness. And that's what you're going to find over and over again in most texts that seem to point to an actual path and way of waking up, is that the thing that is your biggest obstacle is your sense of individualized awareness. That's the thing that you're trying to protect with all these self-serving tendencies. Okay, so to encourage and give happiness to Duryodhana, so to rally and strengthen the psychological defense mechanisms, the aged Kuru, Bhishma, roaring like a lion, powerfully blew his conch. So to rally the psychological tendencies and drives, and to stimulate and nurture, to prevail, individualized sense of self, the senses were stimulated. So that's why you heard me going on and on ranting about how you entertain yourself, things like Facebook and so on. The more you stimulate your senses, the more you feed your senses compulsively, obsessively, the more you support and protect individualized awareness. So suddenly, the horns, the kettle drums, the cymbals, the small drums and trumpets all simultaneously sounded. So that's like the moment when you decide, it's time for me to get on a spiritual path. It's time for me to take this very seriously. And what happens? Everyone, every relative, everything that can go wrong does. Every desire kicks into gear. Everything that you're trying to accomplish, you become overwhelmed with the sense of, no, there's no way you're going to get away from us. And that's, again, when most people falter. Now we're moving on to verse 14. Then standing in the great chariot, yoked to white horses, Lord Krishna and Arjuna, the son of Pandu, also sounded their glorious horns. So what does this translate to? The indwelling spirit of God that commands the senses and the soul's ardent aspiration prevail also manifested signs of evidential power. Krishna sounded his Panchajanya. Arjuna sounded his Devadatta, Bhima of mighty deeds blew the great horn Poundra. So the spirit of God, which is Krishna, manifested as the sound Om. The sound of the prana frequencies of the lumbar chakra, which is the third chakra, also resounded, as did that of the dorsal chakra, the fourth chakra. So the lumbar chakra, the third chakra, is your willpower to move forward anyway, to achieve your inspiration. The fourth chakra, the dorsal chakra, is your faith-based inspiration to continue despite the odds that you see arrayed against you. So each of the representations within the Bhagavad Gita that are on your side, essentially, have a relationship to each of the chakras. So now you understand and see why it's so important to bring your awareness to the chakras, to chant at the chakras. When distractions arise, when your senses internally or externally get stimulated, you give it up to radiant light and you return your awareness to chanting at that chakra because you're empowering, energizing that chakra. And it's these influences of the chakra, the life force soul qualities, which allow you to stay true to your path, to win through the battle. So keep this in mind, that my consistent repetition of the chanting through the chakras, there's a really specific reason for it based upon this particular path. Yudhishthira blew Ananta Vijaya. Nakula and Sahadeva sounded Sugosha and Manipushpaka. I'm not familiar with these words. I haven't read them in a long time. The prana frequencies of the cervical chakra. So the prana frequencies of the cervical chakra, Yudhishthira, and at the sacral and base chakras, the first and second chakras, Nakula and Sahadeva, also manifested. So we're seeing, again, this energization of the chakras occurring in response to the distractions that keep you caught up in your sense of individualized awareness. The king of Kashi, the supreme archer, and Sikandan, the great warrior, Drishtadyumna, Virata, Satyaki, the invincible, enthusiasm, spirituality, self-control, the virtue of equanimity, and the invincible truth consciousness were enlivened and manifested. So by attending to each of these chakras, not only is it energizing them, but it's also going to activate our enthusiasm, our focus on spirituality, our capacity for self-control, the virtue of equanimity, the invincible truth consciousness. All these things become enlivened and then manifest in your life. Drupada, the sons of Draupadi, and the sons of Subhadra, O Lord of Earth, all sounded their respective horns. Concentrated pure love, omniscience, Kundalini Shakti's chakra manifestations, and their qualities were also expressive. So we see, as I've been trying to also share in our meditations, that you are supported on this process. It doesn't mean that someone's going to pick you up and carry you and you're just going to be able to do it all by yourself. There are going to be things that you have to face, all the things that protect individualized sense of self earlier on. But you do have support to help you along this particular path. So verse 19, the great noise burst asunder the hearts of the sons of Dhritarashtra and reverberated through earth and sky. The overwhelming sounds of the prana frequencies in the chakras severely disturbed the psychological tendencies and drives rooted in self-consciousness and spread throughout the devotee's body, mind, and field of awareness. So really this Dharmakshetra, Kurukshetra, this field in which all this is happening, is your own field of awareness. That's really what we're seeing here. And so when these prana frequencies become activated, the psychological tendencies become severely disturbed and they're starting to get uprooted. And that is why when you're practicing meditation, sometimes you might get a little cranky. Sometimes you might be a little disturbed. Sometimes you might be like, I don't need to do this, because that is those other negative qualities getting all unsettled and fighting back in a way. That's why when the distractions come up, you have to give them up to radiant light. That's how you're clearing it out. What most people do is they don't do the giving it up to radiant light, and they just disturb them, and it just irritates you more and more. So the process has to be doing the work, enlivening the prana within the spine and the life force. And then as you become aware of the things you have to deal with, those psychological tendencies, those irritations, those distractions, you have to throw them up into light. And the more you do that, the less disturbing they become, and the more enlivened the prana frequencies are. And you clear out the field, essentially. That's really the goal. So Arjuna, his chariot bearing the banner of Hanuman, seeing the sons of Dhritarashtra at their battle stations, as the clash of weapons almost began, took up his bow. So we're getting to where the two forces are seeing each other, and they're rattling their shields and blowing their horns and trying to, you know, psychologically outdo the other. So Arjuna, concentrated aspiration reinforced by will. That is Arjuna. Arjuna is your concentrated aspiration reinforced by will. Under the sign of victory, Hanuman, aware of the impulses of self-serving psychological tendencies, looking out over the field and seeing all those self-serving psychological tendencies and their resistance to change, prepared to confront them. So we're preparing here. Then Arjuna spoke these words to Krishna, imperishable one, put my chariot between the two armies. So concentrate aspiration. Your willpower says, let's get in between these two armies and really see what's going on here. So concentrate aspiration through pure consciousness asks to be positioned between the two forces so that I may see whom I must fight. I now behold those who are assembled, eager and willing to serve the material-minded sons of Dhritarashtra. So he's seeing all the tendencies and obstacles in his way. And Sanjaya, or intuitive introspection, that's our capacity to go within and contemplate. Sanjaya said, as he's telling the story to deluded mind, thus directed by Arjuna, Krishna, driving the most magnificent chariot, which is your body, placed it between the two armies. In front of Bhishma, Drona, and all the other leaders, Krishna said, Arjuna, behold these Kurus assembled. So he's saying, Krishna said to Arjuna, Arjuna, behold all these Kurus assembled. Analyze the psychological conditions which are restricting your expression. And here we get into the part where Krishna is about to be overwhelmed. Arjuna saw fathers, grandfathers, teachers, maternal uncles, brothers, sons, grandsons, and their friends standing there. So that is your sense of self that really wants to do the right thing, looking out and seeing everything that identifies you as you and saying, what? I have to slay these people? And they use fathers, grandfathers, maternal uncles, because that is how intense the attachment is. Just like you wouldn't want to kill your maternal uncle, no matter how much of a pain in the ass he was. You don't want to kill the thing that keeps you defined as a limited sense of self. He saw fathers-in-law and companions in both armies. When he saw all these kinsmen thus arrayed, overcome with pity and sadness, impelled by excessive compassion. Notice, he didn't say impelled by compassion. He said excessive compassion. Arjuna said, O Krishna, having seen my own kinsmen desiring to fight, my limbs grow limp, my mouth becomes dry, my body trembles, my hair stands on end, my bow slips from my hand, my skin burns as with fever, I am unable to stand firm, my mind wavers. And this is what you experience when you start on this path. You know, it's very rare that you get someone who doesn't go through these kinds of difficulties, where they don't question themselves, where they don't say, wow, this is an overwhelming task. And if you don't say it's an overwhelming task, then you don't really have a clear idea of what's involved. So that's why you know, it's very important to, again, avoid teachings or teachers that just say real simple things like, all you got to do is this. And that's it. you know, and that's rampant in the non-dualist community. You know, in my experience, modern non-dualists, I have not met, well, I've met one, and he doesn't even really teach that much. He's not even really that well known. I've met one that actually seems to have a sense of what he's saying, who's not just out there selling snake oil to make you feel better about the current state you're in. Everything is one. That's it. Well, if everything is one and that's it, why do so many people come to your lectures looking for hope? But anyway, that's another tirade and rant I could go on. But the point I'm trying to get at here is that if the real path, it's not easy. It's worth it. But if you are not in the beginning thinking to yourself, wow, there's a lot to do here, you don't really have a real sense of what it's about. And it doesn't mean that you have to get to the point like Arjuna does specifically, where he just looks at it and says, I can't even begin to approach this. You can get there and you can see it and you can become despondent and say, well, it's a lot, but I guess I got to do it. So everyone's going to approach it a little bit differently. But let's move on with, let me go through this little description of what I just read directly from the Gita. And these things that I'm saying that are translations, they are like little italicized things where it's got the writing of what was actually in the Bhagavad Gita if you just get a non-commentary version. And then this down here is the, okay, here's what it says. And then here's what that actually means. So of all those things I read, on the opposing side, delusion is perceived, the father or cause of births and deaths, and of known and unknown actions, the grandfather, reflective or individualized consciousness, the teacher's mental impressions, the basis of memory, the maternal grandfathers, the mental waves of restlessness and material desire, the brothers or surges of egoism, the sons, products of egoism, grandsons, random waves of desire, and their friends among them, wishful thinking and fantasy. That one's a pretty hard one to kill. On the righteous side is perceived Drupada, omniscient, the father of Kundalini, and many other mental waves of helpful inclinations. So we also are aware that there can be tendencies which are karmic that are also helpful too. So they exist as well. And we want to utilize those, but it's the negative ones that we address. So Arjuna then goes on to dramatize a little bit more. I perceive omens of misfortune, O Krishna, nor can I see any good result from slaying of my kinsmen in battle. I do not desire victory, nor royal status, nor pleasures. What is the value of such kingship? What is the value of self-mastery and self-realization to us, or enjoyment of life itself? Those for whose sake we desire rulership, enjoyments, and pleasures are arrayed here before us, having renounced their lives and their riches. Teachers, fathers, sons, and also grandfathers, maternal uncles, father-in-law, grandsons, brother-in-laws, and others who are related. Though they are intent upon killing me, though those self-serving tendencies are intent upon killing my aspiring drive to realize the self, even though that those things want to kill that, I do not desire to kill them. Not even for sovereignty of the three worlds, how much less for the earth. What happiness can we have by striking down the sons of Dhritarashtra, O Krishna? Having thus banished these aggressors, misfortune would be our lot. So there's confusion here. When you are despondent, you are in confusion. You are essentially seeing all the problems, and you're identified with them in the same way that sometimes people who are identified with their depressive states or their anxiety, you take that away from them and they really freak out because they don't know who they are, what they're supposed to be, or worry is a big one. People who are addicted to worry, they don't want to kill that because it makes them feel who they, like they are who they are. You bring them into the room with someone who's peaceful and not expecting anything of them, that really bothers them because it's threatening their sense of self. So the same thing here, when you begin the process, you can't see any real reason why you would want to get rid of the things that make you feel like you are who you are. Therefore, it is not right for us to kill our kinsmen. Having done so, how could we be happy? Even if those whose thoughts are overpowered by greed do not see the wrong caused by the destruction of the family or the crime of treachery to friends, why should we not have the power of discernment to see the unwisdom of the destruction of the family and turn away from this contest? So again, Arjuna's confused here, right? With the destruction of the family, the ancient laws are destroyed. When the laws perish, the entire family goes to ruin. When lawlessness increases, O Krishna, the women of the family become corrupt. When women are corrupted, confusion of duties occurs. Confusion brings conflict and disorder to both the family and the destroyers of the family. No longer nourished, the ancestors of the family also suffer. By the misdeeds of those who destroy the family and create confusion, the timeless laws which sustain life are destroyed. We have often heard, O Krishna, that those whose family laws have been done away with dwell in a condition of continual misfortune. So what's the confusion he's experiencing? That is when you have an individual. So imagine someone, not you, all right? Because it'll be easier if you think of someone else, if you project a bit here. Projection's not usually advised, but for our purposes, we'll get into it. You know what it means to be spiritual. You have been practicing your meditation, and you're a good vegan, and you never think or have any negative thoughts towards anyone. You are a true, peaceful person. You have your beads, and you mind your own business. Yet, you look out into the world, and you see people, you try to tell them. You're so caught up in your ego. You're so caught up in your individualized sense of self. You need to destroy that, right? So think of your family members, and you try to go up to them and say, you need to practice Kriya Yoga. How are they going to respond? Are they going to say, oh, yeah, sure. I need to turn my life around, and I need to start putting more attention on being calm and clear inside. I need to get away from some of my friends that are dragging me down a bit mentally, emotionally. I need to turn off my social media. Are they going to say it like that, or are they going to say, well, who do you think you are? This is my life. This is who I am. This is what I do. You can't tell me these things. That'll just destroy myself. In a sense, that's what's going on here. That's what Arjuna is experiencing, that resistance. And he's turning it around to say that this is so wrong, that this is like destroying the family. In the same way that personally myself, when I became involved in meditation, being raised a good Catholic boy, and I quit going to church and I quit getting engaged in the power struggles of my family, that was the biggest threat that my family ever perceived. And they came down on me hard. They tried to pull me back into things. And I'd say, no, I'm not getting involved in that. Or with my friends, when I started not eating meat anymore, I quit drinking with them. I started going to bed early and getting up to meditate. They were overcome by this need to say, what are you doing? You're destroying our friendship. When I wasn't destroying our friendship, I was doing what I needed to do. And if that friendship maintains itself, that's fine. But if it doesn't, well, then that's just part of the issue that needs to be let go of. So keep this in mind, that this first chapter, the yoga of the despondency of Arjuna, is representative of when we first realize truly what needs to be done. So we'll go a little bit further in chapter one, and then we'll take some comments and questions before we just barely segue into chapter two. And the rest you have to explore on your own, although this is kind of inspiring me a little bit to want to go through the whole text, maybe as a workshop or a longer multiple week thing. So we'll see how that goes. But number 45, alas, we are resolved to perform unrighteously because we are willing to slay our own kinsmen because of greed for our own happiness. You know, think about it. When you start to have your own boundaries, when you start to take care of yourself, when you start to go to bed early, when you start to quit, you know, supporting unnecessary behaviors, what do people say to you? Oh, you're just selfish. You know, all this meditation, all this, you know, focus on healthy things, you're just doing it to make a big stink at Thanksgiving. You know, you're just being selfish, right? So this is what Krishna is starting to say and think. I would therefore be happier if the sons of Dhritarashtra, armed with their weapons, should slay me unresisting and weaponless. I should rather give up and just remain as a pained, individualized sense of self. Having thus spoken, okay, so now we change speakers here. Sanjaya said, having thus spoken in the midst of the battlefield, throwing down his bow and his arrows, Arjuna sank down on the seat of the chariot, his heart overwhelmed by sorrow. And this is where most people stop. They become overwhelmed by sorrow, and instead of really attending to the battle at hand, they settle for, well, maybe I'll just go to a meditation group and join a church and just feel good about myself. That's usually what happens. And again, it's not to say that those things can't be good social support for people. But when it comes to the actual awakening process, that in and of itself ain't going to cut it. So I'm just going to go ahead and move a little into chapter two, and then we'll have some discussions. So if there are any questions that have come up for you right now based on what I've read, go ahead and type them into the chat box while I go through this. If you don't have any questions, just say no questions at this point. So chapter two. Once we get through the yoga of the despondency of Arjuna, well, now the next stage in our evolution, the next, what is it? So there are 16 stages, the next 1/8, 2/16, whatever. Then we get to the yoga of the knowledge of the imperishable. So what happens when we make it beyond that despondency? Well, I'm going to read straight from the book here for a moment. In the second chapter, instruction in matters essential to understanding the facts of life and awakening to self-realization and liberation of consciousness begins. The original title of this chapter, Samkhya Yoga, Samkhya philosophy enumerates the categories and aspects of cosmic manifestation, explaining the difference between the imperishable consciousness, your eternal infinite self, and the transient cosmic manifestations and forms of nature. When knowledge of supreme consciousness is flawless, erroneous beliefs are banished, enabling soul awareness to be restored to its normal state of wholeness. This chapter has been called the heart of the Gita. So Sanjaya said, Sanjaya, intuitive introspection. Remember, he's telling the story to deluded mind. It's deluded mind that's watching this. Sanjaya said, to him who is overcome by self-pity and despair, whose downcast eyes were filled with tears, Krishna spoke these words. So the devotee in the state of mental confusion and unrest continues to be preoccupied with matters which, while they seem important, really aren't. To dramatize the sadness is immature, emotional display of self-indulgence. However, revelation of truth is about to unfold. Krishna is about to speak again. And what does Krishna say? From whence has this weakness come to you at this difficult time? It is not befitting you who are of noble character. It does not lead to heaven, the state of spiritual fulfillment, and can only cause you disgrace. Yield not to this immature behavior. It is not suitable for you. Abandon the show of weakness and faint-heartedness. Stand up, Arjuna. So petty self-centeredness and dramatization of weakness and cowardice are not soul qualities. They are symptoms of neurosis and dysfunction. Now, many of you know, well, let me go back up and read another. I actually have some highlighted parts of this text, I guess, from a long, long time ago when I first read it. So let me read this to you. We may inwardly know that the course of action we are inclined to take, because of allowing our moods to determine it, cannot result in constructive ends. We may see that we know better, essentially. Indecisiveness, lack of knowledge of meaningful purposes, a negative self-image, flawed awareness of ourselves as spiritual beings, fear of failure, fear of what others will think of us regardless of our actions, fear that it is not right for us to exercise our free will, and other considerations. These impair our abilities to function. So we have to be very much aware of this. So after Krishna says to Arjuna, basically, get up. This isn't right. You know, you are of noble character. You are an aspect of my own clarity. Quit dramatizing. Quit wasting your time. Arjuna says, O Krishna, how can I kill Bhishma and Drona in battle? How can I fight with my skills against these two venerable beings? So, O Krishna, or my divine self, my true reality, how can I eliminate this sense of independent existence, Bhishma, along with memories and habits, Drona? How can I use my skills against these two long-standing conditions? Indeed, rather than to slay these noble teachers, it would be preferable for me to be a beggar here on earth. Having slain the teachers with desire for personal gain, I would only enjoy on earth delights tainted by my actions. And he goes on. There's a lot more he talks about, which is really just saying, I'm overcome by pity and weakness and so on. And we don't really need to keep reciting that. But finally, Krishna speaks. Let me back up a little bit more. So after Arjuna goes on a bit, bemoaning his situation, Sanjaya, the intuitive introspection, which is telling the story, says, thus having addressed Krishna, Arjuna proclaimed, I will not fight. Having spoken, he was silent. O Dhritarashtra, to Arjuna, who was dejected, Krishna smiled, and in between two armies he spoke these words. So by Krishna smiling, it implies that there's no real problem, that the matter at hand can be addressed with objectivity. So Krishna says, you have been mourning those that need not be mourned, and yet you speak some words as if with wisdom. So essentially he's saying, you're grieving about something which should not cause sorrow, and yet you act like what you're saying is wise, which that's what we do, right? Think about it. When you get involved in the path and you start defending yourself and you start getting ruffled by what your teacher's telling you to do and you don't want to do it, you act like you know what you're supposed to do and that you actually have the wisdom. So you've been mourning those that need not be mourned, and yet you speak with some words as if with wisdom. The wise mourn neither the dead nor the living. Never was there a time when I was not, nor you, nor these others. Never will there be a time when we shall cease to be. One passes through childhood, youth, and old age in the body. Even so, beings acquire another body. The wise person is not deluded by this. Material sensations of cold, heat, pleasure, pain, unpleasantness, the transient, the impermanent, endure them while you seek knowledge. So essentially what he's saying is, the problems that arise as you move forward on this path and you seek knowledge, you just got to endure it. That's it. Remember Buddhism, the first noble truth, life is suffering. Make peace with that, you'll be fine. So as you move forward, those obstacles that arise, you don't give up when they arise. You endure them and you move through them. The devotee who is not troubled by these sensations. Now, he doesn't say the devotee eventually does not experience these sensations. He says the devotee who is not troubled by these sensations. The devotee who is not troubled by these sensations, who remains unmoved during episodes of transient displeasure or pleasure, who is wise, becomes receptive to realization of the eternal self. This really is a pretty good chapter. Chapter 2 of the Bhagavad Gita. But anyway, the point I wanted to get at was just to introduce you to what the Bhagavad Gita is all about. Because once you know what the Bhagavad Gita is all about, when you read it, then you get direct insight. It's almost like a map of here's a pit of snakes, here's an ice cold river. Avoid the pit of snakes, but you're still probably going to have to swim through the ice cold river. here's a beautiful mountaintop scene that you're going to see along the way. You know, here's all these different things. So it essentially outlines for you in a very well, very good fashion, the psychology of the spiritual path. And if you can read it that way, it can be very inspiring. It can give you insights. It can help guide you through the process. Some comments that come up. I'm concerned with how to interpret the names given with the meaning behind the names. Okay, Marianne, I'm not quite sure. I'll speak to that in the way I think that you're asking. And then I'll give you some recommendations and you can tell me if that helps. So basically, yes, if you just get a normal non-commentary version of the Bhagavad Gita that just has the verses that I'm reading, that doesn't tell you what the names mean. There are texts like this one, The Eternal Way, which specifically tells you, okay, this name here means this. So you probably want to find out of this book, which I'm pretty sure it's still in print, or I think the commentary from Lahiri Mahasaya also has that in there. The two commentaries on from Lahiri Mahasaya and Sri Yukteswar, while they're very good, it's funny, they say they are by someone else. And so essentially what had happened was this one individual got the texts and published them. And even though they were by Lahiri Mahasaya, since he published them, this fellow put his name as though he wrote them. I don't know why. It doesn't really make that much difference. He does have some interesting comments that I wouldn't pay too much attention to. But if you can get those books, mine are on my bookshelf. They're like orange and they've got a picture of Lahiri Mahasaya or a picture of Sri Yukteswar in it. And that can be helpful. You want to avoid books. The name of the book is the Bhagavad Gita, but this book is The Eternal Way. The Eternal Way, the inner meaning of the Bhagavad Gita. You want to avoid books that treat it as though this is a literal battle, and there are plenty of those. Okay, so the only one that I know the name of and the publisher is The Eternal Way, the inner meaning of the Bhagavad Gita. That's by Roy Eugene Davis, and it's CSA Press. The others, I don't recall off the top of my head, and I have to dig them out. So if you just Google like Lahiri Mahasaya Bhagavad Gita commentary, you'll probably find it. Yeah, good. Someone posted it, the ebook version of it, in the chat section here from Amazon. So that's good. So you can find it that way. But you definitely want to avoid commentaries that are really super religiously driven and make it sound like this is an actual real battle that happened. You're not going to get good information for your purposes. It might be an interesting read, but it's not going to really share the whole real point of the whole thing. You know, we have Yogananda's two volumes on the Bhagavad Gita are excellent too. Again, a lot of people do like it. I do have a copy. I had someone give me a copy. I flipped through it, and as I mentioned, it didn't really. I like Yogananda a lot, obviously, but some things I don't get into very much because, you know, for example, all the commentary on Satan and Jesus and these sorts of things. It's not that I'm anti-Christianity. It's just that, you know, Yogananda didn't believe in Satan. And a lot of the editing that had been done to Yogananda's works after the fact put a big emphasis on that. And I don't really find that to be very helpful. So a lot of people do enjoy Yogananda's commentary. Personally, I don't, but that's just my opinion. It's okay for me to not appreciate someone's work, but also appreciate the person in the same way that I don't know if you've ever heard Yogananda chanting. There's a CD on chants by Yogananda. And I remember thinking, wow, that'll be great, getting chants by Yogananda. And I got the CD and I was so ready to get really into it. And I put it on and I was listening to it and I was like, oh my goodness, turn that off because it was so terrible. like you can't keep a tune. And so, you know, while I appreciate the person, I don't necessarily want to listen to him chant. And I remember Yogananda, or not Yogananda, I remember Roy telling a story where Yogananda said, when he was chanting, he said, you know, when you're chanting, I was told that when I sing, it sounds like someone put cats in a bag and beat it against a wall or something like that. He says, but I don't care. I want to chant anyway with devotion. And that's true. That comes through. That comes through in the CD. You think he's got the devotion, certainly, but do I want to listen to that as a musical experience? No. So don't take what I say about criticisms about particular writings or someone's voice, meaning that I don't appreciate the individual. It's just my preferences are, my opinions are slightly different. All right, so anyway, to get back on track here. So let's get back to the questions. Yeah, and one last thing I will say, I mean, I do talk about it in Kriya Yoga Vichara, and then we'll get back to the Gita, but I want to reference it so that you have something to think about. See, where is it? Well, I can't find it. It's in here somewhere. You know, a person mentioned, you know, seeing Yogananda wearing a cross necklace in the Awake movie. And again, the problem with most of us is we don't really think about history. And when we do think about history, we think about it in such a way that as we just swallow everything as though, oh, that must be true. And I read a lot of history, particularly history from Celtic regions and things, Ireland, Scotland, Norway. And I have also a deep interest in Indian history because I'm interested in Vedic astrology. I'm interested in yoga. And the more you read history, the more you realize, wow, even 1,000 years ago, we barely know what was really going on. We have things that are pieced together and we make up these stories. And when we're in school, we're taught these stories as though, oh, well, this is true and this is accurate. But even 1,000 years ago, most people can't figure out, well, what really happened in this battle or what was really going on with this political situation or what was really discovered here. And that was 1,000 years ago. That's not that long ago. And we try to act like we can actually know history 2,000, 3,000, 5,000, 8,000 years back. We have no idea. Okay, we can imagine things. But as things go through time, we have to realize that some things occur for certain reasons. Like, for example, Yogananda's focus on Christianity, putting Jesus up on the altar. Sri Yukteswar's focus on interpreting the Bible verses in, say, the holy science. Well, for a yogi coming to the West, imagine 1930s, Baptist or Catholic church, and a fellow with a turban, dark skin, walks in, doesn't say anything about Jesus, doesn't make any signs of the cross, and starts talking about Vedanta. What's going to happen in that situation? Really think about that time period, 1920s, 1930s. Does that make sense? Now think about an individual who has a lot of wisdom, who knows that in order to speak to a particular population, they have to use some of the terminology and language and relate it to the religion of the population so that it can be digested a little bit. It's like putting the sugar over the pill, essentially. So when you think about the history of things, even 100 years ago, you got to put it in historical context. You can't just keep carrying things over from the 1920s and 1930s into the 2020s. Because we've grown, we've matured, we've come so far that we no longer have to act this way. I respect many Christians and Christianity. I respect many people of many different religions. But that doesn't mean I have to go around and act like I have to make it makes. I have to make my practice and my understanding make sense in their religion. That's their business. That's my business, right? So just keep this in mind that we have to think very critically, not just about the things that we read and the histories that we are aware of, but we also have to put it in historical context to really understand the reasons why. Okay, that's all. Now, we'll go ahead and move on. So back to the Bhagavad Gita questions. So scrolling up. Okay. So yes, the eternal way is probably a very good one to start with, just because it describes things very, very directly. Okay, so here we are. So what Krishna is saying to Arjuna is that everything is Maya illusion, your family, friends, and those things that define you, and just get on with your duty. Exactly. It's exactly what Krishna is saying. Very good. If we have had many lives and thousands of mothers and fathers and brothers and loved ones, then every relationship is not important and renunciation is not a big deal. Well, the relationships are important temporally right now, but once you become aware of the big picture and you are aware of all the different varied relationships you have had, the less you get caught up in feeling like your world is crushed when one of them changes. Yeah. So this is the first time hearing the Bhagavad Gita and must say the words are too large for my vocab. Without any interpretation, I want to understand what is being said. Yeah, that's why it's definitely good to get a book. And it's also definitely a lot better to take it slowly. You know, I was reading pretty quickly because we only have about an hour and a half together. And I wanted to get the ideas out, which is what was inspiring me to want to take it a little slower and do a longer version of it. But when you get the book, that's the great thing, is that you can just read a paragraph and think it through and contemplate it. So I would advise that. So basically with the original text itself, it's not so long, but with all the translations and comments, it becomes a big book. That's for sure. Like this book is about 317 pages, but if you just get the Bhagavad Gita itself, I remember for a yoga teacher training, one of the teachers gave this out. It was like a pocket version, and it was like this tall by this wide by that thick. So it can fit in, you know, an inch by inch cube if it's just the book. Without the commentary. Dinesh, I don't know if yours is the same. I mean, I got this a long, long time ago when it was in hardback, and Mr. Davis does have a tendency to revise things over the years. Yeah, this was from 1996. So the one you have might be a little bit shorter, but I can't say for sure. Okay, so anyway, this really was just a crash course, in the way to approach these kinds of things. But I want to make sure you have a sense of what I was trying to get at with this description. So before we actually go into meditation, do you understand what I was trying to share? And if you have more questions, I mean, it is pretty straightforward, but if you have more questions and you wouldn't mind typing them in the chat box, we'll attend to those questions before we meditate together. But basically the point is you probably got to get the book. You probably got to spend some time, not going through it as quickly as I did. You know, when I would read this book, I would read one page and one or two of the verses, and I would sit quietly and I would meditate. I'd read a little bit more, and I would sit quietly and I would meditate. So it would take me a long time to go through this book. And that's essentially how you have to approach it too. But it is a wonderful book. And the great thing about it is that when you get through the book, once you get through all the chapters, the yoga of action, the yoga of renunciation, the yoga of meditation, all these things give you insights into, well, what is real renunciation? What is real action and meditation? What are the divine manifestations? What is real devotion? How do we discern between the lower and higher natures? What are the three kinds of faith? Even if you don't understand it the first time you read it, this is why it's so important to read it anyway. And this is why it's important to read it repetitiously. Because even if you don't understand it the first time, what it does is it preps you for direct knowledge and understanding. As you go through your meditation practices every day and you start to have an insight come up, rather than be looking around and saying, what was that all about? Like, oh, I remember reading about something like this in the Bhagavad Gita. So it puts into context your path. And when you have an impressive experience of clarity or silence, and you've read the chapter on divine manifestation or the absolute reality, you're like, oh, okay, I now understand directly what that was trying to share. But the words themselves give you like a structure so that you can make sense of your experience. You could go through an awakening process without knowing any of this stuff. Trouble is, you would stumble around a lot because you'd have an experience, you wouldn't quite know what it was about or what to do with it. The beauty of these books, particularly the Bhagavad Gita, is that if you read it through and you study it, in a sense, it's just preparing you for what's to come. So when it does come, you understand. That's really the key behind it. The question arises, what should one start with, the sutras or the Gita? I read them both at the same time. So what I would do is I had both books, and one day I would read a little bit of one, and the other day I would read a little bit of the other. And the Bhagavad Gita and the Yoga Sutras, we are going to get to the Yoga Sutras in our next session, but the Yoga Sutras, they're not written in the same fashion. The Yoga Sutras are written more... the Yoga Sutras are written more as like a manual. Like, okay, here's what we're aiming for. Here's how we do it. So the Yoga Sutras themselves are more of a practical guide, like a textbook to waking up. Whereas the Bhagavad Gita is more showing you the context of it. It's showing you the actual, the map of the possibilities. So the Yoga Sutras say, to get from point A to point B, you pack your supplies, you get a Jeep, you go in this direction, you fill up for gas here, you fix your car when it breaks down like this. That's like what the Yoga Sutras do. But what the Bhagavad Gita does is it's like, here's the whole map. Here's what you're going to run into. If you go this way, you'll experience this. If you go that way, you'll experience this. So I don't necessarily recommend starting with one or the other. If possible, I would try to just begin slowly over time, reading both. And it's not a race, so it's not like you got a race to get one of them done. Just contemplate a little of each one. So next question. Have you read the whole Gita? Yes, I've read it many times. What do they want of us in this incarnation? I don't quite understand that question. Can you make that a little more specific? What do they want of us? Oh, okay. The Gita, the whole point of the Gita is to awaken up, awaken to full and complete self-realization, to know the truth of what you are. So the end of the battle is being aware of what you are. So it's self-realization. That's the point. Does that answer your question? Because I get the sense that you were wanting a little bit more than that, but I don't think there is anything more. Okay, good. All right, well, since there are no other questions, we'll go ahead and meditate together. So just to tie in what I was saying yesterday about keeping your path quiet into yourself, the very last chapter in the Bhagavad Gita, it says, "Do not speak of this to anyone who does not practice austerities, nor to anyone who is without devotion, who does not render service, who does not want to listen, or who speaks ill of me, or who speaks ill of the process." So in the Bhagavad Gita, it simply states, keep it to yourself. And the final verse of the Bhagavad Gita, which will lead us into our meditation, is, "This is my conviction. Wherever there is supreme consciousness, the Lord of Yoga, wherever there is Arjuna, or a true devotee, you, the self-disciplined devotee of God, there will surely be radiant good fortune, victory, well-being, and righteousness." So, as long as you are on your path, as you endure through difficulties, there will always be good fortune. And in the Upanishad of the Bhagavad Gita, the science of the absolute, the scripture of yoga, and the dialogue between Sri Krishna and Arjuna, thus ends the 18th chapter entitled Moksha Yoga, the Yoga of Liberation. All right, so let's go ahead and meditate together. So take a moment to be aware of the body. Feel yourself, how you experience the seat that you're in, the environment around you. Listen quietly as the observer. Let the body relax as you sit up straight. Now close your eyes and turn your attention within, feeling the body, watching the mind, acknowledging your current state of consciousness, Now putting your attention at your core, your heart, the center of your spine, however you feel your core. Honor and acknowledge the radiant light within you, which is the light of self, the light of your pure infinite consciousness, which is that same radiant light in all beings, all enlightened states, all enlightened powers. It's exactly the same, and it is your very self. Now accept internally that you are supported upon this path for clarity and inner peace and greater realization. That if you can learn to allow it, you can very rapidly and quickly be aware of yourself as the seer, the observer, the infinite, eternal pure consciousness. Just for the next 20 to 30 seconds, hold that in your mind and in your body and in your awareness as you let the breath be your anchor. And now let's practice alternate nostril breathing together for 12 rounds. And as you do so, link the mantra "so hum" with the practice. So on the inhale, hum on the exhale. Taking it slow, but not so slow that you are straining to breathe. Make it comfortable and comfortably deep. And on each repetition, allow yourself to sink more fully into your internalized awareness, your core, your essence. Now, wherever you are in your practice, if you're still doing ultranostal breathing, just finish up this round, whichever one you're on. And rest your hands on your lap, wherever's comfortable for you. And continue on with the mantra, so hum, holding your attention at the spiritual eye center. Keeping your awareness internalized, letting the breath be easy and a little deeper than normal. Hearing the syllable so on the inhale, hum on the exhale. Letting this be your focus to make you more present in the practice. Remember to keep your attention directed towards the spiritual eye. Let the breath be as natural and deep as is comfortable. And the mantra, so on the inhale and hum on the exhale. And it, as any distractions arise, you give them up and allow yourself to more fully focus your attention on the mantra. Now let go of the mantra. Simply sit quietly, upright and attentive, and direct your awareness up to the crown chakra, the crown of the head. And all we're going to do is for the next several minutes is just sit with our attention at the crown, breathing easily and deeply, observing our states of consciousness, and being the seer, the observer. All the while, our anchor is the crown. So always keep your attention gently resting, focused on the crown. Letting your consciousness clear itself out as it will. Now with your awareness at the crown, we're going to move into a little bit of contemplation here. As you sit with your attention at the crown, you are able to perceive the body, any thoughts that arise. You are the seer, which is witnessing everything that arises and falls within your consciousness. So with your attention at the crown, you want to ask yourself, what am I that is able to perceive all of this? And all of this is anything you can experience, whether it's a thought, a feeling in your body, a sound, a memory, an image. Those are all perceptions. Those are all external to yourself. So your goal is not to try to get rid of those things, but it's try to figure out, understand, well, what are you that is aware of all this? So hold the attention at the crown and ask yourself, what am I that experiences this? And when you ask, you just wait a little bit and you watch and you try to feel yourself. You have to figure out how to do that for you. I can't tell you that. And then to keep yourself focused, again, you ask, well, what am I that is aware of all this? You always keep bringing it back to that question and then waiting for the response, the answer to be revealed to you. And all the while, the crown chakra, the very top of your head, that's your anchor. That's just what you're focusing on. So continue in this way for the next several minutes, gently observing and curiously wondering about that question and making sure that you leave space, 30 to 40 seconds or so, in between the asking of the question to watch and wait for the answer to be revealed. What am I that is aware of the feeling of this body sitting in meditation? What am I that is aware of the sounds or sensations around this body? What am I that can hear this voice and perceive these thoughts? What is this, this eternal witnessing presence that I am? Then release your attention on the crown. Release your focus on the question. Just let it go. And now redirect your attention back to the spine, core of your body. And let's practice very gently, but more deeply, Sushumna breathing. Inhaling, imagine feeling a cool electrical current ascending up through the spine. On the exhale, it flows down through the brain, through the spine, warm and soothing, awakening and enlivening your life force, and allowing you to move more fully into your core, your witnessing presence, and that abiding sense of peace, which underlies all of your experiences. So, Sushumna breathing. Cool electrical current on the inhale up through the spine. Warm, soothing sensations descending through the spine on the exhale. Now go ahead and conclude one more round of Sushumna breathing, gently pulling the cool electrical current up through the spine to the crown. Hold the attention at the crown, Breathe normally and naturally, but sit with your awareness at the crown, feeling as though all of your being is flowing up through the crown, merging with your infinite self. Everything that arises flows up through the spine. Imagine the spine like a river of consciousness and life force energy being pulled into the spine and flowing up through all the chakras to the crown, merging with your infinite, clearest, purest self. Hold this point of focus and concentration gently for the next several minutes to conclude our practice. And then you can release your focus on that image and sensation. Just let your awareness flow back down into your body, your usual sense of self, feeling yourself lighter, calmer, and clearer, and acknowledging that it's okay to be your omniscient, infinite, expression of self through this mind and body personality that you are temporarily identifying with. So you're acknowledging that you are the omniscient infinite self relating to this world through your mind, body, and personality. That you are supported in all of your endeavors for greater clarity. You are supported in all your endeavors to overcome any obstacles and difficulties within your life, because that's just part of life. That you are guided by your innate wisdom towards happiness and wisdom and clarity. All these things, wisdom, clarity, knowledge, peace are natural to you. And they are welcome to express easily and freely through you. So feel this, take a few gentle, deep breaths. Let the body relax. And when you're ready, you can open your eyes. And this will conclude our morning session. And we'll return, meet back up, in about 90 minutes, an hour and a half, to explore, introduce you to the Yoga Sutras of Patanjali. All right, we'll see you then.